All right, for Tony, I apologize. Did you have? You were seven. Okay. All right, Steve, you indicated four and six are kind of roughly the same thing. So can I? I'm going to jump down to six and have you merge your comments into six, and then recognize Mr. Harris again.
On both, I know that Finance Committee looked at this, and I know that it's, well, certainly on number four, it's mainly GASB that's bringing this forward, and it may have been Tom Kiever, maybe Matt's leadership as he's played into this, but this kind of stuff's great to see that we're heading in the right direction. Some cities probably haven't even pulled this together, implemented yet, and we're at the cutting edge of putting more checks and balances in place, bringing more money to our coffers, investing wiser, and ultimately bringing down the amount of staff time. As I know, every time the fund balances are looked after, it takes time and effort. So I just wanted to recognize that if there's one role that's so important to local government and to the folks up here, it's looking after the cash that everybody entrusts us with. So just an important note to make. So Matt, continued leadership out of your shop, and good job, and that's all.
Do you want to be your own segue to six, or did you get it? You got it. Okay, Bill?
Yeah, this City Council adopted a resolution approving a statement of investment policy. You sure need some solid policy on this. With the track record for the past 10 years since certain council members like Jill Lutz and Sergio Sanchez and Gloria De La Rosa and the old timers, Tony, you got some bad investments, track records, that's for sure. What is this? Is somebody going to sit over? Are you going to have a committee approving your actions for investment? I don't really understand this, but investment rings a bell here in the City Council. Thank you.
Okay. Bill, you can be your own segue to seven.
Okay, electric vehicle charging station. Why in the heck do you need a charging station in Salinas? Why does the city need to invest in the city? If you need to charge your city vehicles, you got a charging station over in your public works. What are you following, copying Carmel, where they're going to put one by their library? Maybe that's a good idea. Maybe the library ought to pay for it. Put it over by the Salinas Library. Let the dues for using the Salinas Library pay for the charging station. You got to realize it, this is not an entitlements. This is city, or the Salinas city citizens' taxes that you're playing around with. Thank you.
Okay, Joe.
That's just one more parking space that's going to be taken up in front of City Hall. Probably won't be used. It's just amazing that with all the fiasco of green vehicles, that these kinds of things would, people just don't get it on our city council and our mayor and our city government. They just, you know, they just don't understand that these vehicles are not. There's no way they can compete with the internal combustion engine in any kind of meaningful, impactful way that's going to make our lives any better. And when we're lectured of that there's no secret decoder rings, you probably forgot that I said useful idiots do not need decoder rings. They are like dumb ox, and they just blindly go where the masters of this great world government lead them to, and they get the kudos and stuff, and they like that, and so they just go right along taking the citizens who they're supposed to represent and their rights and their freedoms with them.
Boy, I've been busy. All right, Tony.
Thank you. I'm not laughing at Joe. I'm just You know, as I'm reading this report, I guess these questions will be for Mr. Peterson, I believe. As I'm reading this report, I wanted to find out, I know it says specifically that the first year we're not going to be paying for it, and then after that it'll be $20 a month. But it also says about paying for electricity after the second year. What, as far as dollars, what are we looking at right there? Paying for electricity.
Mr. We don't pay for electricity. Perhaps Mr. Ricker would like to speak to that. It seems to be his evening, and it is very, very low cost, very minimal cost to the city, certainly in the first 2 years. Michael.
Councilman, the proposal is a grant for MANBAG, so the city bears no cost for the purchase or the installation of the charging station itself. And over time, as people use the charger to charge their vehicles, there of course is charge costs for electricity. We would make that a pay-as-you-go, so as the client, customer, the city resident is using the charger to charge their car, they would swipe their card and pay for the cost of electricity at the time they purchase it, if you will. Mm-hmm. So it's much like buying gas.
And Mr. Ricker, after the second year on the maintenance, is that a minimal cost?
Yeah, in terms of demand, I guess the question was demand. What will demand be? We don't really know yet. I was just at a meeting last week where there were three cars that showed up, a Chevy Volt and two Nissan Leafs that were there, all of which are electric. So there is a demand. Santa Cruz has put in something like 15 charging stations, and while we're not Santa Cruz, one I think is a start. In terms of ongoing cost, the cost is nominal as far as maintenance.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Steve.
Yeah, just a shout out to this. I sit on the Air Board and on AMBAG as the mayor and the city council's rep, and there was a lot of competition for this. This is a grant that's going to provide a heck of an opportunity. There's some question to the technology, the cost, the maintenance, all that kind of stuff, but there are lots of Valley cities, other cities in the county that would kill for this just as an opportunity and something special. So something I'm excited about, and I think that's just worth saying. So.
Okay. All right. With that, I'm going to go ahead. We're done. I'm going to look for a motion to approve.
Motion.
Second.
Second. Okay. Call for the question.
Councilmember Barrera?
Aye.
Councilmember Craig?
Aye.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Aye.
Councilmember Sanchez?
Yes.
Mayor Donahue?
Yep. Okay, thank you, everyone.
Gary, you didn't give, give me a chance.
Did I miss you on 7?
Green.
You're right. Okay, go ahead.
7.
I apologize. I thought it was a late commentary. My apologies.
On 6, on investment policies, is that the program to invest your money? They asked Mr. Bernanke whether gold was money. He said gold is a precious metal. So Mr. Bernanke is out of order. He doesn't come up with solutions anymore. He's at the end of his Latin. You know, the only solid investment is gold. Anybody else, anything else on the stock market is a gambling. No, that's about 6. Number 7, where would you put a station to load up your car? At a gas station. That's the only place. Either at the gas station or at the automobile sales place. That's the only two places that you can put a gas in. And load up a vehicle charging station. That's what they do in Europe. Are you smarter than that?
Okay. All right. Thank you, everyone. My apologies. All right. We will go ahead and proceed to public hearings. And we are looking for Mr. Ricker. And we're going to talk about polystyrene foam food packaging by food providers. within
Mr. Mayor,
the city
and council
limits.
Members, this next item is a policy matter, and as you'll recall, the council directed staff to bring back a program that would regulate plastic bags for grocery stores and polystyrene food takeout for restaurants. At the time the staff was preparing the analysis, there were outstanding legal questions regarding the plastic bag provision with the city of Manhattan Beach. And while those had been resolved in favor of the city of Manhattan Beach, we had proceeded far enough along that we decided to bring forward today just the polystyrene matter. There was no reference in this proposal for plastic bags. One of the things I want to talk about is our process and what we considered in light of this. And one of the things that I was asked to do and was wholeheartedly behind it is to look at it in terms of City of Salinas values, City of Salinas policies, and to do a deliberative process rather than a keeping up with the Joneses perspective that might otherwise proceed. So I want to assure you that what we went through and just as an aside, and I think Winston Churchill once talked about democracy and its process, but this was first on my desk in 2008. So this is not a rush to judgment in any case. So let me proceed a little bit. One of the things that we considered, among other things, was recent city council decisions to look at the city brand, look at the city image, and to see how we can improve the city's image for many, many reasons. Perhaps one of the things we concluded as part of that analysis was one of the best ways to rebrand ourselves is to be the brand we want people to see. And we looked at several things. We looked at some other cities in terms of what they've done, but we also looked at the image that some cities project. And a city that came to mind is a Southern California city of 147,000, very much the same size as we are. And over the course of the last 20 years, this city, which has always been, I think, a great city, has done a lot with redevelopment to achieve many of its goals. And in terms of finding one picture, one image that can convey the image of that city, I chose this. And I chose this because I think it captured really a certain quality that we would love to have here and we do have here, and that's vibrancy and vitality. And I'm looking at the pedestrian traffic on this street, and the city, again, is 147,000. It's not a big city. But the other thing I note is how clean this street is. For all the traffic and all the shopping that's going on, this is a really clean street. Nothing tears overstating it. Trash and litter really tear at the fabric of our image. It hurts our business community. It hurts them in trying to market themselves in a regional economic competitive market. It hurts our residents and tears at the fabric of their sense of pride of their community. It hurts us in many ways. Litter, we have a litter problem, but we aren't the only one that has a litter problem, and it's not just a trash problem. It's an economic development problem, it's an image problem, it's a maintenance concern and cost, it's many, many things. To kind of share with you, the County of Monterey, in the not too distant past, John Ramirez, who's now the Director of Environmental Health, brought before the County Board of Supervisors an assessment of the litter problem in the county, and they concluded that the county's spending $2 million a year in litter abatement. And while we don't have cost estimates for how much it's costing the city of Salinas and the taxpayers for a litter cleanup, we can tell you this. There are 500 acres of city-owned property within the city. There are 500-plus curb miles within the city. The city's groundskeeping staff is at 25% of its normal staffing levels, and we just don't have the resources to pick up the kind of litter that is out there today. And some of that litter is particularly problematic because it's lightweight and is carried in the wind. And once it leaves the person's car or their picnic bench or their park or the city's property, it ends up in the street. And once it ends up in the street, it ends up in the storm drain. and it becomes a whole other issue. It's now a water quality pollutant, and as we all know, under the Clean Water Act, the city is regulated by the Regional Water Quality Control Board, and under our permit with the Regional Board, we have by law to abate trash and litter from our waterways. So this is becoming an ongoing issue. This is from a December issue of this magazine called Stormwater. It's clearly a major focus of many people now. And what enters the storm drain enters essentially the entryway to our natural system. There is no filter or device that impedes trash once it gets into the storm drain from getting into our creeks and rivers and then onto the Monterey Bay. And while this image is on the screen, let me take a second to talk about polystyrene. Some of the issues that make polystyrene a really great product also make it a really difficult problem, a problem product to work with. It's lightweight, which is great, but it also breaks up and into small pieces. Depending on the kind of polystyrene, I don't want to get too mired in technical discussion about polystyrene, but polystyrene cups and blocks of polystyrene not only break up into pieces, but they break up into small beads, which you can see on this screen here. But even in small chunk form, once it leaves the street and enters the storm drain, it now gets a direct path into the Monterey Marine Sanctuary. And as you can see, this is a quote from the Marine Sanctuary staff. I won't read it to you, but it is an issue in terms of ingestion by wildlife. It floats and it's light. And one of the issues is that food takeout, its useful life, it's used once. And its useful life may be in minutes. The time it takes you to go from the fast food restaurant to bring the food to your desk at your office or to your home, it may be used 10 minutes, and polystyrene does not biodegrade, does not decompose. It will be there for generations, if not centuries. So there's a huge issue, not only in the city of Salinas, not only in the county of Monterey, not only in the region, but also in the marine sanctuary and in our oceans. In a recent study at CSUMB, graduate student Carolyn Roosevelt prepared her master's thesis on beach litter assessment in Monterey Bay on Monterey Bay beaches, and she concluded that styrofoam is the most common type of beach litter. And one of her conclusions was that there is a need for efforts to propose legislation to reduce packing materials and essentially control it at the source. The other thing I want to talk about, I've talked about the cost to the city in terms of maintenance costs and economic costs, but there are opportunity costs. 8 million visitors visit the Monterey Peninsula every year. The tourist industry is a $2 billion industry countywide. One of the things that I learned along this process was that restaurant patrons in the city of Salinas are sophisticated. I was surprised to see this because as a self-confessed green guy, I don't even do this. But in talking to the general manager for the Monterey Coast Brewing Company, found out that their patrons, when they voluntarily have switched to environmentally acceptable products, that their patrons, when they take their food home, they turn over the container to see what number is on the bottom of their container. So we believe that the $2 billion that comes to the city, comes to the county in tourist revenues, and the 8 million people that visit the peninsula are a wonderful opportunity for the city of Salinas to attract more tourists to the city. And these people are sophisticated, they appreciate the beauty of Monterey County, and will pay for the cost to enjoy an attractive place. And much like in the 1970s, when there was legislation to regulate smoking in restaurants, and there was expressed concern that smoking would be the I won't say the death, but be a severe detriment to restaurants' economic vitality, we've seen just the opposite. We believe that will be true for this as well. I mentioned some of the cost to the society, the cost for the city's image, the cost to the business community, the cost to litter pickup, the cost for environmental remediation, the opportunity cost. But what about the cost to the restaurant? In looking at an assessment of a comparison of the least costly environmentally acceptable products compared to the least costly polystyrene products, statewide, the conclusion was that the least costly environmentally acceptable products are actually from 1 cent cheaper per item to 5 cents greater in cost. And obviously it depends on where you buy it and who you and what you buy and how much you buy and a whole bunch of other things. But the cost that's at the front end cost, what we call front end cost, is between 1 cent lower in cost to a nickel more per item. And what was also eye-opening is, as part of this process that we went through, and I want to compliment the community. I want to take a step outside of my normal role as kind of a city staffer. And as we looked at what makes a great city, one of the things that I really am touched by is what makes a great city is the engagement of the community. And we have seen an extended dialogue between the scientific community, the business community, the environmental community, at levels that I have not seen here before, and very eye-opening and very heartwarming to see the discussions, not only the nine that we conducted. We conducted nine outreach sessions with the community in various parts of the community, but there were numerous interactions between various segments of the community that I have no knowledge of who said what to whom about what. But terrific, just whatever dialogue, open, honest, frank discussions, I think they were all to the good. This is part of a survey that the Old Town Association conducted. Here are some of the quotes from some of the restaurants, and to again give some kudos to the restaurants. These are people who, I can't imagine, most people don't like being regulated, but here are people who are saying that they're an advocate for the ban even though they are a restaurant operator. You have in your packet numerous letters. I didn't count them. I'm going to guess 80 or so, a whole bunch. Letters from the Monterey Bay Aquarium. This is some of the quotes from their letter. We have, of the 80 or so letters, I am only aware of one letter in opposition. In terms of support, Old Town Association, after conducting their own survey, found that 10 of the 13 restaurants supported the ban, 2 were neutral, and only 1 opposed it. And the Government Relations Committee recommended approval of this, so we're delighted to have their support. I guess in light of this broad support from the scientific community, from the environmental community, from the business community, it's no surprise in looking at the county and organizations that have previously considered this, that the green area on the map in front of you is the areas that have a regulation governing polystyrene. And it's only those white areas where there is no regulation currently in Monterey County. And if we were to hop across the Pajaro River to Watsonville, we would see not only is the city of Watsonville a partner in regulating this, but every single community in the county of Santa Cruz is also a partner in regulating this product. This is clearly a problem product we believe action is needed on. And just as an aside, in terms of due diligence and being deliberative, last Tuesday, Councilwoman Craig and I attended a tour of the Newby Island recycling facility in Milpitas, and we met with the division manager and a staffer from Dart Industries, who's a leading manufacturer of polystyrene, had a very informative session as they talked about their pilot program, an 8-month pilot program. People drop off their polystyrene there, and it is put through a 2-step process where it is first ground up and then what they call densified or compacted into these long bars, and then it's recycled into, among other things, crown molding and baseboard molding. We didn't get the results of, at least I didn't get the results of that, but I did check with the Bay Area, and there's a regulated monopoly in the San Francisco area that handles all the trash in that area. It's called Recology, and in their similar pilot study, they found that the cost to recycle 100 pounds of polystyrene is $40, and the revenue that that generates is $25 at max. So it's not a cost-effective approach for them. And when I spoke with Bob Besso, who's the recycling and waste reduction manager for Recology, he said, if we can't do it here, it won't pencil in Salinas. So because of that, while we're all supportive of recycling possibilities, we don't believe it's a viable opportunity here in Salinas at this time. And as a consequence, staff is still recommending that the council adopt an ordinance. And let me just kind of walk you through this quickly. I don't want to take up much of your time given the audience and the time. But it affects city regulations. It affects private sector operations, mobile food, shops, gas stations, nonprofits. There's a list of things that are already acceptable that are actually cost less than polystyrene, so we believe they're alternatives. The first 6 months of the program is voluntary. This allows restaurants to exhaust their supplies of polystyrene at no cost. It also allows staff time to develop a cooperative education outreach program with them. There's some list of things that businesses can do to reduce their costs. The last item on the list is to join a co-op to enable them to leverage their costs and get economies of scale for bulk purchases. There's some promotional things that we'd like to see happen to put on restaurants so patrons can understand that this restaurant is using green goods or environmentally acceptable products that can be part of the Green Business Program in Monterey County. And then lastly, staff is recommending that the council approve the negative declaration, introduce the environmentally acceptable food packaging ordinance, and direct staff to conduct a public education campaign. Those are my comments. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to try and answer them. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. All right, we will start with questions from council. Any questions for Jill?
Michael, I just had a quick question about the when you went to visit the DART facility up in Milpitas or wherever it was, there, from what I've read, there's virtually no meaningful food service styrofoam product recycling in California or anywhere for that matter, and that and that's because the styrofoam foodware is contaminated from food residue and therefore the recycling is very limited. Tell me what I mean, you alluded to it briefly, how much recycling of contaminated food products for styrofoam is actually being done at the DART facility? I understand it's less than 5%, is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. What we heard was 5% of the recycling of polystyrene at the facility is foodware. And to back to your question, foodware that's contaminated with food and not scraped clean is considered trash and is not therefore recyclable.
So it has to be washed, as I understand, before it can be recycled.
It has to be scraped. It doesn't have to be rinsed and washed, but it has to be scraped.
Okay. And the chances of a recycling facility being set up anywhere closer to Salinas, what are and that might be a question for
my depth, and I'm going to defer to my associates who work in the solid waste industry to answer those kinds of questions. I honestly don't know the answer to that question.
So, Mayor, could we get an answer from either Patrick or Doug Kenyon?
I might be able to answer because I was on the tour as well. Mm-hmm. That they'd talked about putting a drop-off location here in the city of Salinas. So that was part of what they were proposing when we went over there, was to have, I think it was at the main facility, if I'm not mistaken, if that's right, Doug. Yes, no. Okay.
Patrick
is here,
and
I would love to hear either Patrick or Doug respond to what's the feasibility of that happening here. Is it going to be beneficial? Do you think we'd even get much of a response?
Well, can I use my 2 minutes while I'm here?
Sure.
I was going to limit my comments to 2 minutes, so I'll try to keep myself very brief. The issue of recyclability, I think, you've already heard, there's going to be a lot of, I think, comment tonight about the bigger issue, which is the environmental impacts. But I'll give you my perspective on the recyclability. It's a low-value market, so I think, as we've seen from the work in San Francisco and our own, it's not a break-even proposition necessarily. It's good to hear that companies are offering to bring those that equipment here because we really do have other polystyrene products that we have to deal with that aren't part of this ban, and those are specifically the packaging we all get when we buy products, and specifically products we buy overseas or outside of the state of California. Those are the what they call nurdles, the little tiny pellets of polystyrene that I think if any of you have ever broken one of those, you understand the problem. When you break it, you get snow.